Yes, Judge James Bredar is in the news. He's been in the news a lot over the last couple of years because he is the judge that has overseen the consent decree.
5 years now.
In our fair city, and he has had a lot of rulings and a lot of opinions. But he is in the news for a different reason.
He joined
this
a club,
morning.
Didn't he? Didn't he join a new club?
That's right.
Membership into a new club?
That's right. You know, maybe we'll give away free coffee
there
mugs or
go.
Something like that. Because, yes, he was the victim, I guess is what we call it, of the squeegeers in Baltimore.
Initiated.
That's right. Initiated into the club of those who don't want their windows washed, but get them washed anyway. But he got even more. You know, he didn't just get his windows washed. He got a couple of things written on his car, apparently,
racist.
In soap. Here's what happened, according to the Baltimore Banner, first to report this, but we have confirmed it. We actually have the police report.
I have the police report in my hot little hands.
Thanks to Phil Jakubowski for that,
Phil.
From the newsroom, who has the police report. A lot of things redacted in it, but we have enough to tell you that the judge, on a Sunday afternoon, about 1:40, I guess he was listening to the Ravens game here on WBAL radio as he was driving around Bolton Hill. Got off of 83, got to the intersection at North Avenue and
Mount Royal.
And there were a couple of squeegeers who surrounded his car. His wife was driving. He was in the passenger seat.
Mm-hmm.
The squeegeers said, "We're going to wash your windows." Actually, didn't even say that. They just started to wash his windows. They said they didn't want it. And he has a picture of one of them giving them the middle finger.
Mm-hmm.
And then he says they wrote the word racist in soap on multiple windows. So he called the cops, and the cops came and they talked to these guys who, by the way, are 20 years old.
Not kids.
They're 20. And they told him, don't do this again.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do this again.
Wave their finger. By the way, I think it's in here. They waved their finger when they said, you young man.
And nothing more happened, and they were just given a warning, and everybody is safe and happy and moving on with their lives.
Now, the irony in all of this, if you want to call it that, is just a couple of months ago, August the 18th, was the last meeting. They are intermittent, these meetings with the consent decree folks. Everybody goes to the police commissioner. There's a community consent decree apparatus. They all get in front of Judge Bredar. Mm-hmm. They say, okay, what's up? How are we doing lately? And while they were discussing, Bryan, the ongoing need for 400, I went back and looked at a news story from August. 400 police officers short. All of a sudden, squeegee kid issue came up.
Right.
And when the squeegee kid issue came up, it was Judge James Bredar that said enforcing the law should not be a problem. He didn't say go out and arrest the squeegee kids, but it came up. And Commissioner Michael Harrison talked about it on the steps of the federal courthouse after it was over. But now this judge finds himself in the same position, if you remember, State Senator Antonio Hayes, who is my state senator, represents me.
Mm-hmm.
He was accosted by squeegee workers at Conway and Light Street. And if that name rings out to you, he was accosted just a few hours before 48-year-old Timothy Reynolds was shot and killed by the 14-year-old back in August, like 8 days after all this happened. I'm saying all this, Bryan, because this is right in front of us, and we still have to come up with these high-profile incidences to prove that this should stop. That if the judge who is overseeing how to not be brutal to the public gets brutalized,
right.
I mean, what does that tell you?
Just how broken this city is.
That's right.
And has been for quite some time. And, you know, we have a reluctance to do anything about it other than just give them a warning and say, move along. Come on.
So how many other people listening out there have gone through the same thing Judge Bredar went through? By the way, the police responded in 5 minutes. Did you see the amount of time it took for the police to get to look at the time?
I did notice that.
5 minutes. Yeah. So I'm just saying, how many other people out there, though, might not have gotten the same type of attention that the judge got very expeditiously, I'll say. And look, we're talking about this because it's Judge Bredar.
Yep.
But this is still happening. It looks like we're acting as if because the Squeegee Collaborative has been meeting that nothing's going on.
No, you're absolutely right. If this was, Michael Williams
there
who got
go.
Pulled over and had racist written on it and had problems with the squeegeers and had to call the police, this would not make the news. And I'm sure there are all
these Sergeant, the judge, he's out there to traffic. Get somebody over there!
Yeah, it's the consent decree,
it's
judge.
The judge.
You might want to make sure that everything's
Get over there. Take a police report.
Above board on this aspect. But yes, this is why it's made news. And unfortunately, that's the case now. Unless somebody gets shot or there's a big name person that is involved in these things or there's some kind of assault that's associated with the squeegeers, it's just white noise because it happens all the time. It happens all the time.
Incoming, soon to be, Baltimore City State's Attorney,
Ivan Bates,
thank you. He'll be joining us 5:30 Club next Wednesday, by the way, in studio at 9 o'clock, so we'll get to talk to them in person about this. But his continued comments are, I'm not trying to arrest all these young people. I'm not trying to do what we did back in the 2000s mm-hmm. under Martin O'Malley and zero tolerance. But you can't do this.
Mm-hmm.
This is one activity you can't do. And I don't know how clearly, like, we have to make it, how do you do it? You do it by saying, don't do this, warning, do it again, citation, and next time you're arrested. Once that consistency, Bryan, gets out, you'll see this go way down. You'll see it go way down.
I totally agree.
You're a two-strike person. First time and the second time you get the cuffs. He's giving it a third, but what he's saying is definitely on the third.
You'll get
arrested.
But if your policy is this is not going to be tolerated, it will only take months, maybe a year before it just goes away because they know they were not going to be able to do these things.
Correct.
That's the issue. I mean, like, these things about, you're ultimately going to have to make a couple of arrests because they're going to test the system.
They're going to see
well, how far you're willing to go. But if you have a policy that it will not be tolerated for you to go out and squeegee and walk into the middle of the road and harass motorists, it will end at some point.
And the judge being the latest victim, and I'm not, he and his wife are going to be okay.
Yeah, they're fine.
But being accosted in this situation only highlights, though, that, you know, they said no. Look, if anybody has been watching this whole process with Judge James Bredar, he's 65 years old, and I'm saying that because it's in the police report. Mm-hmm. He is one of the most level-headed, like balanced judges. He doesn't scream. He's not. See, I can imagine when the kids come up, he goes, no, wait, just like we all do, mm-hmm. waving them off. For him to be, you know, racist or the car, it tells you what he's with his wife. His wife is driving the car, according to the police report.
Smart man.
There you go. But I'm just saying, what happens to others is where I go with this. What do you think? I think people deserve the right to be upset. People say, well, why aren't you pleasant to them? What if I don't want to be pleasant?
Yeah.
I have the right to go get the hell away from my car.
Yeah, you do. Absolutely, you do, right?
Now, I'm not saying you should do that.
No.
I wouldn't do that. But I'm just saying.
Because you don't know how explosive the situation could be. The smart move is just to say no.
My thing is, it doesn't matter whether you're pleasant.
Yes.
It doesn't matter how gracious you are. If you don't give up money, you're going to feel the wrath.
That's right. And in some cases, if you don't give up the money, then you're deemed to be racist because, you know, you're not going to give money to this black kid.
And the other part about this, I hope the judge sees, and I don't know how many, because Mount Royal and North Avenue, everybody, is one of the busiest corners in the city with four different intersections and jumping on 83, mm-hmm. getting on 83, all that stuff. And I don't know if the judge realized that a lot of this also, though, Bryan, is racial. You're seeing particularly white drivers and white women who are approached more aggressively because they think they can intimidate and make them give money up. It is. And that's another part of this that needs to be really looked at, is whether or not these kids are selectively applying this.
Well, maybe, but I mean, there are plenty of black city residents who have texted us or have been interviewed by the news who are outraged and so sick and tired of dealing with it on a regular basis.
But I'm telling you, underneath that, because it was an African-American woman that had a gun at Washington Boulevard that pulled the gun out. But I'm telling you, underneath it, though, Bryan, why Judge Bredar and his wife? Like, why so aggressive? And I'll bet you there were other cars they weren't aggressive with. Elderly, woman driving,
sure,
white. I'm just saying that that's an underlying thing that needs to be addressed, is why the overt aggression. It's one thing when you get a no, but why have to spray the windows and all that stuff, do all that stuff?
Well, it just added to the list another thing that has happened with a high-profile person, and, you know, luckily it just ends with this. But if you want to stop it, it can be stopped. There just has to be a will to do it.
So,
and I'm glad
question.
That Ivan Bates has said another interview where he said, don't really care what the collaborative says. It's they can't do it.
He said, I want their input. Love to have their input, but this is what we're going to do.
Yeah.
Sure. Tell me what you come up with. That's great. Later on in the show, everybody, for 9 o'clock news, we really want to talk about this from the standpoint of, what do we hear from our leaders today? I would like to know what the mayor thinks today about the consent decree judge and what he went through. other state senators, delegates, councilmen, all the people that have weighed in, you know, with the sympathetic squeegee kid, you know, scenario, what do they think about what happened to the judge that's overseeing the consent decree?
Do you think it really has changed the mayor's mind on this one bit? Why would it change? You got a person who was murdered.
I understand that.
You know, we have assaults on a regular basis. We had a state senator who was accosted. Why would this change his mind?
I'm not asking whether. I want to hear what they have to say. Is this how they want to put a shingle out and say, welcome to Baltimore? Is this what they, that the judge that is trying to put guardrails around the police department, this is what he faces, and his wife, on a Sunday.
It is interesting. There's somebody who I follow on Twitter who is an uber-liberal in Baltimore City who posted pictures of the Inner Harbor yesterday at lunchtime and talking about publicly, out loud, how empty it was, how desolate the city was, how there's nothing going on in the middle of this city during a Monday when it's 60 degrees out and sunshine.
And it normally would be filled a bit before 8 years ago in the riots following the death of Freddie Gray.